this morning, and I wrote down this song. Just can't remember who to send it to. That I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times that I could not find a friend. But I've always thought that I'd see you, baby, one more time again. Gotta see me through another day. My body is aching and my time is on hand. I won't make it any other way. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. Sunny days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times that I could not find a friend. But I've always thought that I'd see you, baby, one more time again. Towards the sun. Who knows the wind blows and you turn your head around. The girls in the telephone line talk about things to come. Sweet dreams and flying machines and pieces on the ground. Days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times that I could not find a friend. But I've always thought that I'd see you, baby, one more time again. Thought I'd see you one more time again. Coming down my way. Thought I'd see you. Thought I'd see you fly away. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never. Times that I could not find a friend, but I've always thought that I'd see you again.
Coming today as we celebrate the life of Matthew David Hilton. My name is Doug Cowart, and I'm one of the pastors right here at Life Church in Moore. We're here today because each one of us, in a unique and special way, connected with Matthew. And our lives are richer and fuller because we've known him. Today we gather to remember, to ache, to cry, to laugh, and to smile, to reflect on and celebrate a life that was full of family and friends and purpose. More than anything I can say today, it is your words and your memories, and most importantly, simply your presence and your hugs of support for one another that will memorialize Matthew. Even though Matthew is the subject of these moments, we are the beneficiaries. By that I mean we're going to be built up and strengthened and comforted in two ways. As we remember Matthew, and we are reminded of the lessons of his life, there will be places that we grab a hold of the memory of his life and we walk forward honoring him as we are impacted and changed. But we're also going to acknowledge and remember God as well. As we remember Matthew, we worship God. We'll gain perspective of a God who loved us so much and was so good that he blessed us with 33 years of one of his most precious sons. Will you please join me in prayer? Father God, you are our Father. And we ask that you would hear the cries of our heart today. In our grief, give us comfort and give us peace. You are in control even when we lack control over things that matter so much. You're the one who gives us perspective on this life. So I pray that you would bring comfort and peace to all who are here today, and that you would open our eyes to how you're working even now in the middle of our grief. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Without a doubt, since the passing of Matthew, since we found that out, a flood of memories have come back to us, and we remember the stories and relive the experiences we've had during our time knowing him. Matthew was a man of impeccable wit, and he had a calming spirit and effect everywhere that he went.
Right.
Words used to describe Matthew were loving, kind, generous, funny, and joyful. But he didn't just give joy, he didn't just find joy, he gave joy away. He was a joyous presence everywhere that he went. I got a chance to meet with the family, with Rachel, with Mom, Carol, and with Brother Mitch, and close family members and friends. And we talked about Matthew's legacy and his life, and we reminisced about some great times. We shared impactful stories. We laughed a whole lot, remembering a guy who had a gentle spirit, a godly man who loved like Jesus. He loved his three boys, Joshua, Caleb, and Elijah, more than anything except for Jesus and Rachel. He went home to be with his father in heaven on March 9, 2017. Which brings me to the number 9 when we talk about March 9th. What a number. It was his favorite number. He was born in September, the 9th month, married Rachel on January 9th, 2009, and he went to be with Jesus on the 9th of this month. He loved the number 9 so much that on the 8th of September, 2010, he not jokingly, asked Rachel if she could hold out just one more day so they could have their son Caleb on the 9th. Another number that is so powerful in this man's life is the number 33. He lived 33 full years on this earth, the same amount of years that our Savior Jesus Christ lived. And I think you guys are going to see a connection between these two. Along with being supremely witty, Matthew was super intelligent. In fact, in kindergarten, he tested as a genius, and he was placed in a gifted and talented program immediately. He was a published author at 9 years old, and he didn't even like to write. A published author at 9 years old. There's that number again. 9 years old. He loved music, starting as a child. He taught himself to play the drums, the piano, the guitar. God gave people like Matthew so much musical talent because they didn't give me any whatsoever.
That's right.
Matt's taste in music was what you could say was bizarre, but kind of refreshing, right? His family said he had CDs that went from on the same CD from Lil Wayne to Kiss to Waylon Jennings. Just absolutely incredible. And he loved Counting Crows. Counting Crows was one of his favorite bands. Family was so important to Matthew. We recounted a time in which he went to visit one of his aunts in Kansas when she was sick. And to enter the room where she was at, you had to put on a protective mask around her. So what did Matthew do? He didn't wear a protective mask. He wore a Batman mask into the room. And he made his aunt laugh so much that she would have to catch her breath, and she would go, shoo, shoo, to be able to catch her breath. And from that moment on, she was Aunt Shu, and Matthew would call her Aunt Shu. He would send her pictures of shoes, and it was always Aunt Shu from that point on. 2006 was a big year for Matthew. It was a big turning point in Matthew's life when his father David passed away. Matthew was living in Lawton, and he moved closer to Moore so he could be close to his family. And 3 months after moving and relocating as a manager of a Home Depot right here in Moore, he quickly struck up a workplace romance with what would be his wife and his biggest supporter, Rachel. 3 short years, they were married by the same bartender at the place where they had their very first date. And this is how special this couple was. This man got ordained just to do their wedding. Just to do their wedding. Matthew was always tech savvy, and he loved to give mom a hard time because she wasn't as tech savvy. So she had a difficult time keeping her phone updated, and he'd often take her phone and play some funny games with her. And one of the things that I found really, really funny is Matthew was a huge supporter of President Obama. Huge supporter. Mom? Not so much. Not so much. So when he was updating her phone one day, he actually took the phone and he made the auto response on the text say, "I love Obama." So anytime somebody texted his mom, they got that response right away. I know Carol loved that. He also had a funny relationship with his mother-in-law. Rachel recounts that her mom would always tell the kids, "Grandma loves, Grandma loves," and she would say, "Grandma loves," and Matthew from another room would yell, "Tacos!" So, "Grandma loves tacos," or whatever it might be. So Matthew was always poking fun at someone in his witty way. 2 years ago, Matthew experienced congestive heart failure, but this wasn't his first battle with health issues. Earlier in life, he experienced 2 brain bleeds, the second of which, when he was discharged from the hospital, this man went swimming that same afternoon. We want to talk about a trooper. This guy had some resolve. When he was going to explain to Caleb about exactly what was going on with his heart, he gave him all the information, and Caleb was like, "Oh, so it's like an Iron Man's arc reactor, this thing right here." Just like that. He's like, "Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely." Matt was a superhero, just like Iron Man. I see a lot of Iron Man shirts out there today, and I know Matthew would have smiled in seeing all of that. Every time Matthew was referred to a new doctor in some of his health battles that he had, he loved to mess with the nurses. He wore an LVAD, which is what ran his heart, and he thought it was so funny when a nurse would come in to try to find his heartbeat or to try to find his pulse or to take his blood pressure. He'd let him put the cuff on and all of that stuff, and they couldn't find anything. So he thought it was absolutely hilarious. He would laugh on the inside and a lot of times on the outside and just let them go about it until they figured out exactly what they needed to do. Matthew found himself in the ICU 2 years ago. And what many people may not know is that up until that point, Matthew was an atheist. And Rachel would tell you that she was agnostic at that point at best. And she had begun taking small steps toward Jesus. But in a transformative moment, facing impending death, Jesus radically changed Matthew's heart in an instant. Matthew leaned up in his bed. He grabbed Rachel's hand. He looked her in the eyes. He said, "Rachel, will you follow Jesus with me?" Amen. And they've both been fully devoted followers of Christ ever since. Matthew's favorite book of the Bible was Leviticus. It wasn't Leviticus. I don't know if you guys know anything about that, but Leviticus is not, it's a difficult book to read. His favorite book was Matthew. What else would it be, right? Matthew was the first volunteer that I ever met when I came to Life Church in Moore. Matthew was going about doing baptism follow-up, and the way in which he went about doing that, he just had such a joy about him that it was contagious. He was making a difference in people's lives, but what he would tell you that he was doing was following Jesus. And for this reason, I knew Matthew was the perfect person to bring on to our life group's leadership team, and Matthew was so excited about stepping up and getting that journey started. Above all, Matthew loved community. His life group was called Gather, and that's exactly what they did. Matthew was an includer, and he didn't want anyone to be left out because he knew the power of doing life together, because he fully believed that where 2 or 3 gathered, Jesus was there with them. Rachel would describe the last 2 years of Matt's life as the best 2 years ever. They were the first people ever to conceive a child on an LVAD. I want you guys to think about that. The first ever. That's big time right there. And she felt as if they were granted these 2 years to make the most of them, and they did just that. Time doesn't allow us to recount or recall every story or search out every word to describe Matt, but where we remember him and we think of his example, we honor him and we thank God for the life that he lived.
When life leaves you high and dry, I'll be at your door tonight. If you need help, if you need help, I'll shut down the city lights. I'll lie, cheat, I'll beg and bribe to make you well, to make you well. When enemies are at your door, I'll carry you away from war. If you need help, if you need help, your hope dangling by a string, I'll share in your suffering to make you well, to make you well. Give me reasons to believe that you would do the same for me, and I would do it for you. When you fall like a statue, I'm gonna be there to catch you, put you on your feet, you on your feet. And if your well is empty, nothing will prevent me. Tell me what you need, what do you need?
there goes a hero.
Amen.
Matthew was a hero to his family, to his wife, and to a lot of people in this room, I know. Story after story, memory after memory, Matthew Hilton was a wonderful, family-oriented man. But if we stopped there, if we walked away now, we would miss it. We miss the truth that Matthew was more alive today than he ever was. And what Matthew would want each of you to know today is the message that shaped his life. Each of us will be alive and aware, experiencing life after our earthly bodies have been laid to rest. And there is only one way to control what life looks like. And that's through a response to Jesus Christ. If we could hear from Matthew just one more time, his message to us now would be that the things that we often think matter the most, successes and hobbies and achievements, and yes, even family, all fall underneath the priority of establishing a nurturing relationship with our Savior, Jesus Christ. Sure. And if you had to get down to the center of what Jesus Christ said, it was one that one needs to believe in him and follow him for eternal life to be spent with God in heaven. In fact, he said in the book of John, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live." He said that in one of the most fascinating stories that the Bible has. It's filled with a captivating picture of both Jesus' full humanity and his total divine nature. For just a couple of minutes, I want to share this story with you, and we're going to see an amazing response from Jesus that I know is going to move all of us. As the story opens, Jesus is on the road, and he's traveling with his disciples, and he's teaching in the villages. One day, he receives word that one of his very best friends from home has fallen ill. The message was quite urgent: "Come now, or Lazarus is going to die." Jesus' response was a curious one. "The sickness that Lazarus has won't result in death, but it is for the glory of God, so that I will be glorified in it." And even though he got the terrible news, the Bible tells us that he remained there for 2 more days, teaching in the villages with the disciples. So 2 days later, Jesus decided to head back to the town where Lazarus and his 2 sisters, Mary and Martha, lived. They were also really good friends of Jesus, and as he and the disciples got close, the women came out to meet him. They were absolutely incensed that Jesus decided to take his good old time in coming on back. They were upset, distraught, because in the time in which Jesus heard about Lazarus falling sick, and between the time that he left there, Lazarus had died. Their brother had passed away. If only he had left sooner, he could have done something. They wept, wondering why Jesus had lingered. And in this, I love Jesus' response. There was Jesus, already knowing that Lazarus would not remain in the grave, yet confronted by his weeping sisters, aching with loss. What did he do? Jesus didn't act right away and make everything better. He didn't bring Lazarus back immediately. No, his human, understandable response was that he wept. Jesus wept. It's the shortest verse in Scripture, but quite possibly the most powerful verse. Jesus wept. But why? What would cause the Son of God himself, who knew the end of the story, what would cause him to weep? What were the emotions that he felt in that moment, and why did they overcome him? These are my thoughts, but 2 come to mind. Number 1 is Jesus felt their pain.
That's right.
Jesus hurt when his friends were hurting. They were in deep, inexpressible pain, just like us. They were filled with doubts and questions. How could this have happened? How could they go on? What were they going to do? How could they live without Lazarus? They were in tears, and Jesus felt their pain. He bore it with them, and it drove him to tears. What we see here is not only is Jesus watching, but he cares deeply. In his humanity, he feels what we feel. Friends, it's okay to weep. It's okay to mourn. Matthew's passing. It's good to do that, to acknowledge the depth of the emotions that we have and let them out. It's good because when we mourn, we are blessed by the comfort of Jesus himself. He's there by our side, holding us up, strengthening us, giving us strength to take the next step. I know the family was strengthened even in the most difficult moment when Matthew's words were right before he went back to that last surgery. He said, it's okay. It's okay, because if I don't make it, I know where I'm going.
That's right.
His assurance of his destination because he accepted the free gift of salvation that comes through Jesus. His resolve was 100%. I know where I'm going. So why did Jesus cry? Why did he weep? First of all, it's because he felt their pain. The second reason that comes to mind why Jesus wept was that Jesus saw our need. Jesus wept because he was reminded by what was right in front of him, that the greatest need of the world that he loved so much was to be rescued, to be saved, because of this sin-drenched world that we live in. Death is a reality, and it needs a solution that we as humans cannot provide. Jesus heard and he cried that day. And in the end, he provided a rescue for Lazarus. In his perfect power, he raised him from the dead. Jesus provided a resurrection. But Jesus knew that it wasn't just Lazarus who faced death. Every single one of his friends surrounding him at that moment would eventually face death. Their earthly life would end. They would die. Lying in front of Jesus was the inescapable reality that for every one of his friends, the wages of sin was death. And the same is true for us. I believe that on that day, Jesus may have been very aware of our needs on this day, and there was something that burned inside of him in a way that drove him to tears. It drove him to set his face towards the cross. There he allowed himself to experience this death, and through his perfect death, he bought life for all people of all times. Once again, he provided a resurrection. Matthew could talk to us right now, in this moment, I think that he would tell you that his desire is not the ultimate legacy be that he was a good family man or that everyone has good things to say about him. What is true, what he would tell you, that his legacy is that of a man who has been rescued, a man who has been saved. For as long of a list of good characteristics that we could sit here and talk about Matthew, he would tell you there were places that he messed up, that he didn't do the right thing, he made mistakes. Matthew's mistakes, his sins, resulted in a separation from a holy God, and yours and mine do the same exact thing. Sure. Because of the things that we have done wrong during our lives, we have been separated from God, permanently, totally, eternally separated. We can't possibly do anything to make our way back to God. The debt we owe is too great. We're already imperfect. We violated a holy God, and on our own, even if we do what is considered religious behaviors, we cannot undo what has been separated. But God, through Jesus, made a perfect way for us. Jesus lived that perfect life here on earth, and God allowed him to pay that penalty that we have all earned. He hung on that cross and died and provided a way out for us when we couldn't do it on our own. He was the perfect sacrifice to pay the debt that we couldn't. And then he rose again, taking and proclaiming the final victory. For those who, like Matthew, understand this and become a follower of Jesus, there is forgiveness. There is a rescue. There is a peace and a purpose in life that Matthew had. And today, because he put his love in Jesus and his trust in Jesus, he asked him to forgive him of his sins. And Matthew Hilton is with Jesus right now. I fully believe Matthew is standing in the presence of Jesus right now. His faith was in his Savior. And we know that the last breath in this world was his first breath in the next. And if Matthew were here right now, question that he would ask all of us would be the same one that he asked Rachel in that hospital bed. He'd grab your hand. He'd look you by the eye. He'd look you in the eye. He would just intently say, "Will you follow Jesus with me?"
Amen.
In a moment, I'm going to ask our worship pastor, John, to come up, and we're going to sing and we're going to worship God together. This is one of Matt's absolute most favorite things to do, was to worship God. And I know that he would have wanted all of us to worship together. And I know he's in the presence of God, and he will be worshiping with us as we sing.
I'll trust in you, I'll trust in you.